Yep. Pardon? Oh, no. Yeah. All right, cool. Sorry about that. How weird that it kept going. Hey Steph, how's things?
Good.
Good. Week's been good? Good week?
Oh yeah.
Yeah, awesome. And the kids behaving themselves?
Questionable.
Do they ever? Just speak with confidence. That's the trick. So, everything's all good. Is there anything particularly you wanted to check on your presentation?
No, just work.
Excellent. So I'll have it all set up, ready to go. So pretty much the first slide of the button to go forward, the one to go backwards, and if you want to highlight anything, this left-turn microphone should pick up most of what you're saying. If though, we'll be here. If too quiet or anything like that, I'll just run up.
Hey!
Yeah, pretty much. I can pass you one of these, but it's too annoying to try and talk into it. Excellent. I've got your handouts. Did you want us to split them on all the seats before
up
people arrive?
Yep.
Is that easier? Yep. Yep. Perfect. Anything else? Cool. Excellent. Love it. You'll be fine. All right, Kim, should we see how this all goes? Yeah. problem that we have with you, Kimmo. You talk, I'm like, I just want to know more about that. I need to know more about that. So, yeah. Yeah, it's just amazing the stuff that you that's all looking great. How long do you think you need that? Perfect. I'll give you 10 minutes. I'll just get the background. Perfect. I only just got your email, but I've got it. Let's present it. Only a mum can say that, yeah. And did you want me to introduce you guys, or do you want me just to play that song when they're all having it? And then you can just come up and straight into it?
Yeah,
perfect.
Yeah.
Easy. Cool. Yeah, you had so many.
Oh, true,
last
yeah,
time.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, there's like nothing that's wrapped. I thought I can't go around handing out.
Yeah, my kids think you just like
bit
Christmas
COVID-y.
Or something. Yeah.
I'll have to remember it that it's October.
Alright, I'm ready when you are.
Was that one in yesterday?
Yep.
It was.
No. That was.
That needs to go.
Love and happiness.
Yeah.
3 o'clock in the morning, yeah. Talking about how she can make it right.
Oh,
yeah.
Worth the wait.
Yeah.
So good, isn't it?
I'm
always
the guys. The guys we're staying with, they got to stay for lunch. You know, this time up.
I don't know how they like.
Yeah,
they're the true heroes. And these are the handouts just to go on the chairs. No. To their credit, I only asked for a whiteboard. chairs. No one sits in these front chairs. If you wanted to move any, you're guaranteed to have this hole here.
I'm still
Okay, everyone. We're going to get started on our third of our interactive sessions. How are you all feeling? Oh, a few sore heads, it looks like, out there. To those at the wine tour, good to see some faces here. I think some people are probably still in bed, but it was a great day had by all. And yeah, hopefully everyone else got out there and enjoyed the day yesterday. Some good news, there's lots of snow falling at the moment on the mountains. So those looking to go skiing or snowboarding tomorrow, it looks like it will be a good one. No guarantees, but yeah, hopefully tomorrow is the day, or Saturday, Sunday, if you're hanging around for a bit longer. Today, we have a lot to get through. We have two amazing presentations, so we're pretty much going to get straight into it. Get your cheers ready. It is Thursday night, prize bonanza night, so all the photos that are in the competition do win a prize. So thank you to our sponsors for that one. If you're yet to submit your photos, please make sure you keep them coming because tomorrow we do still have prizes left. I think that's it for me. So let's give a big round of applause for our first presenter, Stephanie Nixon. Steph, come on up.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to Thursday. So as you said, I'm Stephanie Nixon, so I'm just going to talk a little bit about myself and then we'll get into it. Hopefully that works. Yep. So who am I? I'm a partner, I'm a mum, I am an advanced care paramedic from Charleville, Queensland, which I'll talk about in a minute. And I've worked rurally as a paramedic for the last 11 years, mainly in Charleville, but I've also worked in some smaller stations as well. Currently, I'm writing for the Response magazine through the ACP, so Australasian College of Paramedicine. I'm also studying part-time to do my extended care. And I've also just got a grant to do some pain management stuff. So hopefully that will also be good for my area and get some more pain relief in. But obviously not exactly what I'm talking about today, but just relevant. So I'm from Charleville. Whoops. From Charleville, we have a population of about 4,000 people, which is quite large, obviously. We're very, very rural. In where I work, we have an 8-on, 6-off roster. It means we work for 8 days straight, 24/7, and then we have 6 days off. But your 6 days off are really just working all the sporting specials that no one else wants to work. Yeah. And all the overtime that comes from being out west and nobody's out there. We have two paramedics where I work. So in the smaller stations around where I work, which are 2 hours away, it's all single officer work. So you work on your own and you have a driver, hopefully. So at the moment, I'm also working in Mitchell, which is a small station. You have a emergency driver, we call them. So you just ring them and you hope that they're in town and you take them with you, hopefully. We're 2 hours from our nearest backup in Charleville, which is another ambulance. And we're 3 hours from our closest CT. So anything that comes in usually gets flown out by the Royal Flying Doctor Service. We have a hub in Charleville. And very rarely will we road them. We're also 8 hours to our nearest trauma centre. And usually, again, they'll get flown. Back in the day, they used to get driven, but they don't do that anymore. So the topic I'm talking about today is implicit bias. And this is a really, really important topic. And even Amanda yesterday spoke on her own experience on having to check her privilege when she attended a patient. So today we're going to focus on what implicit bias is, how it's affecting our patients in and out of hospital, and ways that we can do better for our patients. So first I'll start with what is implicit bias. So everybody here has implicit bias. It's something we all have, and it's built from where we came from, what we've learned, our upbringing, our life experiences, all the information that we've received. So everything people have told us, everything we've seen on TV, the interactions that we've had. And the perception that we have, it shapes what we view of the world and the people in it. And this is just reinforced over and over whenever you have those connections, those reinforcements happen. And this is our implicit, so our unknown, our unconscious bias. And this includes our perception on things like ethnicity, gender, age, socioeconomic background. And this is also known as stereotyping, so where we put everybody into the same box. So as you can see on the screen, explicit bias is the opposite. It's where we're quite open about it, where it's known. So the example here is women who are mothers aren't serious about their research. And so that's very obvious. Whereas the implicit is that person then not hiring somebody or not promoting somebody because of that. And not outright saying, hey, you're female, I'm not going to promote you. It's inward saying, actually, I'm going to promote this other person, but internally thinking, I'm not promoting that person because of this. So why does this matter? Why does this matter? It really matters. Stigmatizing a patient, regardless of the reason, can actually really affect their overall healthcare journey. And we'll talk about that with a case, or a few cases actually. So clinicians actually have the same rate of implicit bias as the general population, which is scary given that we're healthcare professionals in a setting that really impact patients. And our patients shouldn't have to receive a lower level of care or standard of care because of any unchangeable characteristic that they might have. So the cases we're going to think about today and explore on further are two patients that are 60-year-olds with abdominal pain. So these patients, when we're thinking about them, they come at us with the same symptoms, the same amount of pain, and they'll end up having the same diagnosis. So they're just what I want you to sort of think about while we're going through the next few slides. And the next part, I want you to shout out some answers for me. So this is our first patient. So what do we think are some of the possible implicit bias for this patient group? Shout them out. Drugs, yeah. Yeah. Yep. Yep. Homeless. Yeah. There's no wrong answers, really, honestly. Yeah. Gambling, ex-cons, dirty, jobless, homeless, useless. So it's quite a lot of things that if you haven't internalized and thought about what your biases are, you could affect this patient. You can make sure that at triage, they weren't seen quickly. You could have a big impact on their journey. Next one, patient two. What are some implicit bias for this patient group? No one wants to say it. Girly, overdramatic, wrong, against God. These are all things, if you're brought up with very Catholic, this is not somebody you want to treat. This isn't somebody you're going to give the best standard of care to unless you have acknowledged that yourself. Dirty, wrong. So there's all these things that could impact this patient without even knowing what's wrong with them. Shout them out. Addiction, yep. Alcoholic. Yeah. Yeah, self-inflicted, low intelligence. You start getting some racial issues happening for this group. Yeah, alcoholic, drunk, probably a frequent presenter. And again, all these will impact how this patient is treated, how they're looked after. They get that wrong nurse, that wrong doctor, that wrong paramedic. This group... Where's the DNR? Is that what? I feel like that's the first words most people say when they walk in the nursing home. But again, that's our bias, you know? Elderly, frail, oh, they can't do anything for themselves. Oh, they wouldn't know what medication they're on. Oh, they're not really worth the time in the hospital. These are all things that start coming through when we attend these patients if we're not checking ourselves. So if we check ourselves and go, oh, I'm at a nursing home, they might have a DNR, they might not be able to do anything, but also they might be able to. And it depends on what we've had through our life. If every older person you've gone to hasn't been able to get out of bed by themselves, you're probably just going to assume, well, none of them can't get out of bed by herself. So you're not going to try, you're not going to ask, you're just going to be like, oh, we need the stretcher, she can't move, she can't do anything. So you start impacting your patients because that patient goes, oh, no, I can do that. Thank you. And now she doesn't like you anymore. Good luck. And then she's not going to like that she had to go to hospital. She's not going to like that she's in hospital. So all these things, that those small little things build up. So we'll just go back to our case with the 60-year-olds with abdo pain and the two houses that they were in. So we're going to assume that these two patients were attended by the same paramedic and they had a bit of implicit bias around low socioeconomic patients. So the first house, patient's going to be respected. They're going to be believed. It's a nice house, nice area. They're probably a good person. We're going to be pretty quick to do our abdominal assessment. You know, we're believing that they're in pain. We're believing what they're telling us. So we're going to get in. We're going to do that abdo assessment. We're going to ask the appropriate questions. We're going to care about their pain levels. We're going to give them probably IV, maybe IM, depending what your preference is. If they've got nausea, vomiting, we're going to try and treat that. We're going to take them quite seriously. We're going to take them to hospital, obviously. And we're going to hand over that, you know, we've picked up Jill. She's a 6-year-old with abdo pain. We're very concerned as she hasn't gone to the toilet. So we're going to make it quite serious. We're going to be very concerned about this patient. The assessment and scans, they're going to get done quickly. That nurse is going to say, oh, that paramedic's actually a bit worried. Okay, we'll do a scan. We'll get everything checked. They're going to have a very early recognition of that bowel obstruction. That patient's going to have early treatment and be fine. Not poor Bob. So Bob's not going to be respected or believed by this paramedic that has a bias. They're gonna be like, yeah, do you though? Are you sure? You're not just drug seeking. You're not just looking for something. You just want a bit of alcohol. Have you been withdrawing? They're not probably going to get the appropriate assessment, especially if this paramedic doesn't want to touch somebody. They think, oh, they might be a bit dirty. I'll skip the abdo assessment. I'll just do something else. They're going to be asked quite heavily about their smoking, their drinking, the alcohol. Is it that? Probably is. So they're going to get their handover. Oh, yeah. He's just been drinking, probably. He said he had a liter last night. Yeah, he reckons he's got some abdo pain. Yeah. Yeah, he says it's pretty bad. Yeah. It's about an 80, he said. But, I mean, he looks pretty comfy. He looks all right. So that scan's not going to get done with urgency, is it? No, that nurse isn't going to go, oh, this patient's pretty bad. That nurse is going to go, oh, all right, well, they're not too worried. I don't need to be too worried. So he's going to have that very late recognition of his bowel obstruction. He's going to have late pain relief, if he gets any. And he's going to have a whole host of issues ongoing. And guess what? Now he'll call you more often because he'll have other issues because of how long it took to get recognized. Or he won't call you at all till he's almost dead because the last time he called, he wasn't believed. He was treated like shit. So what has this looked like in real patients? Got a few coronial inquests for you. I don't know if you like your coronial inquests, but I enjoy a good coronial inquest. there's some good ones out there. So the first one I want to talk about is Miss Du. So she was a 22-year-old female, and she ended up dying in police custody from sepsis. Yeah, pre-treatable thing in the early stages, especially in a 22-year-old. So she was taken into police custody for a few fines that she'd hadn't paid. So she ended up in police custody, and each time she said, oh, I've got quite a lot of pain in my ribs. They said, oh, what? She's like, yeah, I got domestic violence. I got whacked over a few months ago, and I've got some rib pain still, and I fell over the other day, and my rib pain's worse. So the first police officers went, yeah, all right, we'll take you up to hospital. At the hospital, the police officers told the triaging nurse that she only started having pain when they took her into custody. So she wasn't taken seriously at the hospital. Each time she attended, she didn't have all of her vital signs taken. Not once in the two presentations that she had was her temperature taken. And very limited times was her blood pressure taken. And each time she was sent back to the watch house and told that, nah, she's fine. She's just overdramatic. She's just, you know, we don't know what, there's nothing wrong with her. So then the police said, oh, well, there's nothing wrong with her. She keeps telling us she's in pain. She can barely walk. No, she's faking it. She's been to hospital. She's cleared. She's fine. So then she became very unconscious. And they took her in the police car because they thought, oh, we're not ringing an ambulance for this. You know, there's nothing wrong with her. She's just got a bit of pain. She's probably drug-seeking. And she died as she got out of the police wagon and went into the hospital. And they reached just for 45 minutes, and she didn't make it, obviously. It's a cranial inquest. And so a few things that came out of this in the areas of implicit bias was that nationality, she was Aboriginal. She's young, 22. Nobody dies from 22 from sepsis, you know? No, you got to be at least like 50, 60. Gender, so she was female. She was in police custody. Everyone just thought, ah, it's incarceritis. She just wanted to get out of custody. Domestic violence. She used to be a drug user, so they just think, ah, she just wants more drugs. And she had low socioeconomic status. And all these things played towards her not being believed, just like our abdo pain, her not being listened to, and her dying. The next one is Miss Day. So she's a 55-year-old female, and she was sleeping on the train. That's how her day started. She was sleeping on the train. The train officer, I don't know, train officer came over, and she didn't have a ticket. So he called the police. He's never, ever called the police on a sleeping person before. And he's worked with the rail for several years. So he rang the police and said, oh, she's being, she's sleeping, she's being unruly on the train. We need to get her off. So the police attended and they thought, oh, she's actually all right. She's probably a bit drunk. We'll take her into custody just to let her sleep it off. While she was in custody, she fell a number of times while no one was watching her on the monitor. She pretty much couldn't really walk to the police car when they took her in. And everyone just thought, ah, she's just drunk. She's just intoxicated. And it was hours before an ambulance even came to check her. Even though she'd stumbled off the train, they weren't able to find anyone for her. She wasn't able to answer questions. And the ambulance came and they thought, oh, yeah, she's probably intoxicated. But obviously, there's the risk of something else, so they took her to hospital, not in any rush. And they didn't recognise any obvious signs because they weren't looking for them. So there was, I think there was a lump on the back of her head that it was found at hospital when the doctor did an actual assessment of the patient. And she also had, I think it was a blown right pupil that, again, wasn't picked up until later because nobody cared to look. Everyone just thought, oh, she's drunk, she's intoxicated. We don't need to do a full assessment on her. So she ended up dying in the hospital from a brain bleed from the falls that she'd had in police custody. And when they looked into these police officers, they'd actually attended a similar aged female who was white, and they had dropped her home. So instead of dropping this patient home, they decided to take her into custody. So they found that the train driver, or train person, actually had called the police because she was Aboriginal. And he thought that she was being unruly because of his bias towards that. So the reason that she ended up dying in police custody while no one was watching her was because of implicit bias. She was 55 years old. She was female. Again, in police custody, the stereotype, drunk, sleeping on the train, must be drunk, can't be anything else, and just low socioeconomic status. So those, these are the two that I've talked about, and you might say, oh, it's the police, not us. It happens to lots of people. Mothers not being believed about their sick children. Oh, it's a first-time mum. They don't know what they're talking about. That kid's not that sick. Kids don't die. So kids dying when parents don't be believed, their care not escalated. Another lady pregnant, and she'd had a couple of episodes of problems with her gastrointestinal issues prior, always vomiting, nausea. They just put it down to that, and she ended up dying from dehydration and malnutrition through her pregnancy and was not once referred to an obstetrician. So this is what's happening. And these aren't old cronial inquests. You can look them up. 2019, I think, is the oldest one. So this is still happening in our healthcare systems with our patients. So what can we as professionals do to try and work our way through this and help these patients that are the most vulnerable? So we can own our own bias. We can acknowledge that we all have bias. We can think about what our biases is, and we all have them. It doesn't matter who you are. You have some form of bias. The main thing is trying to see the person as an individual and not as part of that stereotyped group. Because once we see them as that stereotyped group, we've lost them. They're going to become whatever that group is, and they might be nothing like that. They might be, which is fine, but at least we've considered them as a person. We want to consciously work towards addressing and changing our own biases. And this can look like pausing and reflecting after our interactions with our patients. So when we have a patient interaction, when we finish, just pausing for a second, being like, yeah, I did all the treatment that I would do for anybody. I've done everything I could have done. There's nothing more I could have done. Yep, I'm happy that I did everything I could for that patient. Or the opposite. It could be like, well, why didn't I take those few minutes to do an ECG? Oh, because I was thinking it probably wasn't that because of this. But, I mean, that doesn't rule that out. Okay, next time I'll just make a note to make sure I do an ECG on that patient or a blood sugar on that patient. Or I'll do a temperature on that patient that felt unwell a week ago. So it's really those basic, what can I do better for this patient? We can try to see from the patient's point of view. These patients call you on their worst day. Nobody calls you on their best day. Nobody goes, oh, fantastic today. I know what I need, the ambulance. Yeah, so these are these patients' worst days. They might not feel like it to you. You might be like, ah, Jill had a pretty worse day than you, Bob. But this is their worst day. And even if that's three times that day, that's still their worst day. And it's just looking at it from their point of view. Maybe they haven't been believed the last few times they've called. They haven't been helped. They haven't been looked after. Nobody's organized the care for them. So it's those really basic things that could matter a lot for this patient. And we also want to make sure we're spending time with people of different backgrounds, if that's our bias. So if we have never spent much time with Chinese people, it'd be going and spending time with them, learning about their culture, learning about them, so that when we attend those patients, we feel comfortable. We're not going, oh, not sure how to help you or what your culture is or how this is going. You know, same as if you don't like children. Go and spend time with children. Learn how to interact with them, how to play with them, how to be with them, because these are the people that you'll be attending. You're not just going to attend the middle-aged white man every time you go to a patient. So it's making sure that we're acknowledging what our bias is and working towards ways that we can do better for all of our patients. It's practicing mindfulness and making sure that we're going, yeah, I'm going into this situation. Like she said yesterday, I'm checking my bias before I walk in. I'm checking my privilege and I'm thinking, what can I do to better this patient? How can I have compassion for this patient and help them get to where they need to get to? Even if it's 3 a.m, I've seen them 5 times today. What can I do to help them this time? And we want to advocate for our patients, because advocating for our patients, we are in the best positions to do this. We are people who see them. We are people that go to them, and we are in tremendous power to help advocate for them and get them to the places they need to be. So we're just going to talk through how we can advocate for our patients. First thing we can do is put patient first language. So instead of being like, oh, Jill's a diabetic, we can say, this is Jill and she has diabetes. So we're separating the person from their diagnosis. So if we just say, oh, Jill's having a seizure again, she's epileptic. Okay, well, Jill sometimes has seizures. She does have epilepsy, but she's also a person. She likes knitting. She likes going out in the afternoon. She's got a dog. So we want to separate the person from their medical condition, because they are more than their medical condition, and they want to feel like that too. want to eliminate pejorative terms, so we want to make sure we're not using words such as seeker, druggo, freak, even though I know we love them, frequent flyer, hypocrite, because these actually start a power difference. If you think of someone as, oh, it's just druggo Bob again, all right, let's go pick up Bob the druggo, you're already thinking he's less than you are. You don't know about Bob. Bob could have done great things, and he's just ended up in this terrible position. So we want to make sure we're not having a power difference, that we're putting everybody on the same level. So we want to make sure that we're using power words and making sure that we can empower them as well to get them the journey that they need. We want to use inclusive communication where we can. So that's using whatever their preferred pronouns are, and that makes them feel that they're in a safe environment where they can actually come forward and probably tell you things that they wouldn't have told anybody else, or they haven't told anybody else. You see this a lot when we bring people in and then they tell everything to the doctor. So it's making sure that we are providing a space where they feel open enough that they can approach us. So using terms such as spouse or partner instead of husband or wife, and not making those assumptions about patients. It's all about making them feel comfortable and being able to open up and know that we are there to advocate for them. Want to avoid labeling our patients. So this is things like when you say, oh, he's just a bad historian. Okay, well, maybe you just haven't actually sat down and talked to him properly. Oh, he just doesn't take his medication. He's not compliant. Okay, or he can't afford them. So there's ways we don't want to label patients, because if you take that patient and say, oh, he's not compliant with his medications, hasn't been taking them, I wouldn't bother. That nurse isn't going to bother giving that patient those medications. Whereas if you come in and say, hey, unfortunately, he hasn't been able to take his medications because he doesn't have a car at the moment because it's in the shop and the pharmacy's too far to walk to and he doesn't have any family in town, so he can't get somebody to come and get his medications for him. Suddenly, that nurse is going to go, we're finding the medication. We're going to do this. Where's the taxi? We'll get the taxi to deliver them. So all of a sudden, you've shifted that from, yeah, he doesn't take his medications, to, hey, we've got a problem with this patient being able to take his medication. How do we make that happen? It also can prematurely give a diagnosis. So just one of our examples, oh, she's just drunk. She's an alcoholic. Okay, so now we're not going to investigate for a stroke. We're not going to investigate for hyperkalemia. We're not going to investigate for anything else because, oh, now they're just drunk. Hospital said they're drunk. They're drunk. So we want to make sure that we're not prematurely giving that diagnosis and closing that off, and then that patient not being able to get the help that he wants, such as, yeah, it's just encephalitis. Okay, no, it's sepsis. Now she's dead. So we want to make sure that we're opening the dialogue and making sure we're not doing that. And as the cartoon says, Joe, please, just call me Joe. Because we have lots of labels, but people know what they want to be called. We want to eliminate any weaponizing quotes that we do. So these are the good old paperwork where you put it in inverted commas. Patient is lying. So you're saying, oh, patient's got 10 out of 10 pain. Oh, their pain's really bad. That's weaponizing those quotes. I'm not going to believe that patient. That patient's got 10 out of 10 pain. Oh, okay. Sure he does. So all of a sudden, we're stopping that patient from getting the pain relief that they actually need because you've labeled them and weaponized these quotes against them. So every time we do this, we reduce that patient's lived experience. We're inferring that that patient's a liar. Don't believe them. They're lying. We don't need to do anything more for them. They're a liar. Don't believe anything they say. And it makes the other professionals go, oh, maybe he's lying. Like, why would that paramedic say that if it wasn't true? Because we have a lot of privilege in our positions, so we are believed. We don't want to blame the patient, which is very easy. You think, oh, they did it to themselves. Because nobody chooses their circumstances. I'm pretty sure if everyone could choose their circumstances, it wouldn't be homeless on the street. And we can't judge somebody unless we've been in their shoes. We don't know what they've been through. We don't know where they've come from, who they've known, what they've done. And we need to be strong advocates for these patients when no one else will be. And we are in the prime position to be advocates for this patient and all patients. And we can empower them to seek that change themselves. You know, it doesn't have to be us that does it, but more and more, if they see that they can do this change and that people believe in them, they'll change. I've had a patient, very bad mental health, domestic violence situations, and because we advocated for him to not see the doctor that wasn't a great doctor, he went to hospital and he actually went and saw a different doctor and got the help he needs, and now he's doing fantastic. And it's because he had that person that said, you're right, you're not going to see that doctor who belittled you and made you not feel worth it. We're going to find you somebody else and we're going to make it work. Try not to lead with the social identifiers, because although you may know your bias and you might have worked towards it, it doesn't mean everyone else has. So if you open with, oh, this is Bob and he's homeless, all of a sudden that nurse might think, oh, homeless, dirty, bum, not really worth it. It's probably not going to take his medication anyway. I'm not going to bother trying to treat him and make him feel better. So all of a sudden you've started that implicit bias in that other person because you're leading with things that don't matter at the moment. Obviously some things matter, but it's the time and place for that. So obviously the homelessness does matter, but it's how you bring it up. So if you bring it up as like, oh, Bob's homeless, he's not going to do this. Whereas if you say, hey, Bob's got this, this has been happening for him, he's been trying really hard. Unfortunately, at the moment, Bob doesn't have a home, so we're really struggling with him being able to get anywhere. He's not in a safe environment. He's not doing well. What can we do to make that better? Can we get some funding to get him housing? Is there emergency housing? Can he stay in the hospital for a few days till he gets it all sorted out? Can we try and ring family and friends that he's been too afraid to ring because he doesn't want them knowing that he's homeless on the street? So there's all these things that we can do for our patients that will make a huge difference. And we really need to understand these factors and how we can help. So I just want to leave you with this. So what is your implicit bias? How have you negatively affected a patient's pathway? How has someone else you've worked with negatively affected a patient's pathway? And how will you ensure that you're positively impacting every patient that calls you? How will you be better for your patients? Because no one calls you on their best day. And then TED Talks if you want to watch them later. And some references. Thank you.
Thank you, Steph. And what a great advocate for patients there and some really good take-home messages for us. Unfortunately, we are a little bit tight for time today because our next presentation is going to go a little bit longer than our other one. So we probably don't have any time for questions for Steph, but I'm going to dob you in it and I'll say that Steph will be around. So please feel free to go up to her and ask all the questions that you may have. There is some delicious looking food over there. But just before we get there, let's give out some prizes. So you guys should know the deal by now. Loudest cheers going to win our main prize, which is either your choice of a Kathmandu voucher or Rebel Sport voucher. So let's start off. This is from our wine tour yesterday. What do we reckon? I think the people on the wine tour, that was New Zealand's largest wine cave, also known as a basement. So next one, that was our yesterday morning session. Yeah, there's some more duck lovers. Another one from yesterday morning. There we go, it's not bad. In the snow yesterday. Well, one clap, good. Oh, what do you reckon of that? That's pretty impressive. No, just me? It's a very tough crowd. All right, we've got a winner, sorry, Thar. Let's try and out-cheer that one. Aww. That's a bit too much laughing there. A bit of a Titanic reenactment. Quite impressive. I got a bit of a video here. Oh, nice one. And last one from the night luge. No one likes night luging. There you go. All right, so well done to everyone who entered. I reckon that's probably worthy of the main prize. Bit of a consolation prize there, yep. So everyone else who entered, please come see either myself or Dylan down at the table. We have some t-shirts, hats, and a whole bunch of other gear from Ski Map It. So yeah, please see us and we'll hook you up with a prize. So let's just take a quick break, grab heaps of food, and we'll get started shortly. Thank you. Okay, everyone, I warned you it would be a short break, so we will start kicking things off again. Please feel free, though, to grab more food. There is plenty more up there. I'm sure at the end of the sessions there'll be a lot there as well, so don't forget to bring a little bag and fill up on, I don't even know what they are, ham and cheese, croissant, things. Each sort of conference, we usually have one or two presenters that return, and one of our huge supporters over time has been Kim Lappin. So Kim rocked up to our Bali conference in 2019, I think it was, and since then we just keep asking her back, and she's always very kindly come along, helped us out, and has been a great support of Dylan and myself over the years. So we're really excited to have Kim here, and she's also brought Tahlia and Michelle with her. So could we please give a huge round of applause for Kim, Tahlia, and Michelle.
Thanks, Dylan. Can we have the two mics? Is it okay? And can I just go back to that photo? Okay. Hi, everyone. Firstly, I was hoping you were listening to one of my favourite songs by Amy. I'm just going to go back to it for a minute. Another one of my favourite songs. You might get my whole running album on this. And feel free, I'm free. You're out to get up and dance and move about. And while Quentin's fixing this for me, I'm just going to add that normally I like to be really interactive, and I mean really interactive. So has anybody come to a presentation by myself and my colleagues before? Okay, so you've definitely missed out. Normally I would get you up and I would make us do something, and that's what we do in mental health. We get people to be interactive, to discuss, and to be part of the presentation. So I do encourage that today. I won't make you do a role play today, but I will maybe suggest that maybe we could do it at the closing party, in that we are talking about intoxication. But in the lights of Amy, if we go back to that picture, I just want you guys to take some time just to view this picture, because I'm going to come back to it later and there will be prizes. Hands up, who likes Amy anyway? Yep? Okay. Does everybody know how Amy died? Yep, hands up. Who wants to tell me how Amy died? Yeah, alcohol poisoning, 2011. So Amy was one that joined the 27 Club. Does anybody know what the 27 Club is? Yep. Does anybody not know what the 27 Club is? Okay. The 27 Club is a group of people that have all died at the age of 27. And most of these people have died from addiction or substance use. A couple have died from freak accidents like electrocution. But most of them died at the age of 27 from their substance use or behaviour attached to that, whether that be suicide or accidental death. So this picture is of Amy when she first started her career. And that last picture is probably one right before she died. So I just want you to take note of those two photos, because I will come back to that later on and I will be asking some questions related to those photos. So I think when you look at it, it really makes me sad from beginning to end, and at such a young age, 27. I mean, none of us want to die at 27. Well, I'm way past 27, so I'm safe. So we'll now move on. So beside me, I do have Tahlia. So firstly, I am Kim. I'm the CNC at the Gold Coast University Hospital. That is me in Bali. And I specialise in mental health. So I've worked in mental health for over 34 years, and probably in the last 24 of those years, I've specialised in acute psychiatry and being at the front end. I also develop lots of models of care, and I'm really lucky that Gold Coast has given us the privilege to look at different models of care, being innovative and looking how we can produce better care for our patients. Tahlia is one of our CNs that works in the acute care team. Prior to working in adult psychiatry, Tahlia worked in child and youth mental health, so is a great asset to our mental health team in ED, assessing our acute psychiatric patients that present. And Bucko, as we call, is our NUM of governance for ED. So it's a collaborative approach between ED and mental health, and showing what we can do if we work together. This is a quote that I love, and it's by Henry Ford, and I think it sums up what we do at Gold Coast. So coming together is the beginning, keeping together is the progress of it, and working together is success. So I think I really like to reflect on that at all times. If we can come together, join together and work together, we get really positive outcomes. Okay, so we're going to try. I hate standing up in here, so I'm going to walk around. So we're going to look at, try and get through all of these topics. And in saying that, when I was putting this together, I thought it was going to be an easy feat, and I had to cull a lot. I could do 2 days on this subject and keep going. So first we're going to look at a brief overview of us. The problems, we know it's not unique. We know all you guys have difficulties with this population. We want to look at what we, you know, what happens if we work together. I'm going to show a TED talk because I think it's a brilliant TED talk, and I'm not sure if anybody has seen this one. Hopefully if you have, you'll appreciate watching it again. We're then going to look at our definitions, which Tahlia is going to speak about. So we're going to look at psychosis, intoxication, drug-induced psychosis, and how we really differentiate between that when we're seeing them in AD, and then looking at some interesting facts. And again, those interesting facts, I could have spent hours talking about the interesting facts because there's so many. We're going to look at the half-life of the common substances that people use. We're going to look at some case presentations. We're going to pull on our data. If we're running short of time, the boys will give me a heads up and we might have to skim through that. We're going to look at the trends of our data and the problems with our data. We're going to look at the ED avoidance strategies. And as I said earlier, Gold Coast Health has been wonderful in allowing us to be really innovative, thinking outside the square and looking at how we can put in place models of care to avoid ED. We're going to look at our assessment guidelines and our aims, and then we're going to give it to you for questions. But remember that photo from the beginning because that's going to come back into it, and there are prizes. So this is our big hospital, Gold Coast. Very flash. This is our population, over 700,000. We have two hospitals. So we have Gold Coast Hospital based in Southport, and we also have Robina Hospital, which is our smaller hospital. We have a total of 89 emergency department bays.
And 40 at Robina. So we've got, that's 89 at Gold Coast University Hospital, but there's about 40-something emergency beds at Robina Hospital.
And between 2013 and 2020, the mental health presentations went from 6,000 to 11,000. So that's a massive influx of presentations for us. And if you look at the, in 2014, it accounted for 4.2% of ED presentations, and in 2020 it went to 6.5%. So we all know the problems that come with people there, as our topic said. Everybody knows what our topic means, doesn't it? PFO versus DIP. Does anybody not know what PFO or DIP means? Yep. PFO, pissed and fell over. Yep. DIP, drug-induced psychosis. So what we're trying to show is that we often get lots of presentations that look similar. So how do we look at the differences and treat them effectively? And I might at this point put hands up who works in ED departments. Yep. Hands up to the paramedics. Hands up any allied health. Yeah, a couple. Any mental health professionals. Oh, one. Well done. It always seems to be the case. There's limited mental health that are coming to conferences, and we are trying to increase that. Is there anybody that doesn't work within those areas that I've asked? No?
Yes.
One?
Ready work.
ICU, great. So we send lots your way, normally. Yep. Yep, we can't manage their behaviour. Yep, we tube them, and we send them up to you. And unfortunately for you, yeah, it's then your turn to try and manage the behaviour when they wake up. Yeah, so sorry about that. So we know the behaviour. It's problematic. It's often aggressive. They're often non-cooperative and they're often agitated and distressed. You know, it's not uncommon. We know the risk of the physical adverts of withdrawal, loss of consciousness and rapid deterioration in their presentation. We know they get a low triage score, and it really builds on what Stephanie was saying around bias. And being the number of governance, Bucko's nodding ahead, we know it. They turn up, they're frequent presenters, everybody knows them, they get this shit-ass score of 4 or 5, and there they wait. And then their, you know, agitation becomes more prominent, they become more distressed, nobody's tending to them, and we end up using suboptimal treatment, which we end up sedating, tubing, or we end up secluding. And if you look at the research on seclusion, the impact on the patient is awful. Patients will say, you know, I was living with this fear in my head. You know, I was paranoid, believing people were going to kill me, they were going to kill my family. And then I get locked up on my own to deal with this fear. And if we can all just reflect for a minute, when we're really scared of something, do we want to be locked in a room where we cannot get out of, that we're trapped? So we're thinking somebody's going to kill us and we're locked in a room. Can't get out. We would be petrified. Overshadowing. Now, this is a big thing of mine. I often talk nationally on the overshadowing of mental health and AODs. And again, there's a huge risk that comes with that. So often our mental health and AODs population turn up. Nobody looks at the physical health. They're quickly triaged. They're quickly referred to AODs or mental health. And again, builds on Stephanie's talk around the bias. Lots of their physical ailments get missed. And then there's, you know, adverse events that come from that. And again, our most frequent presenters. The countertransference, the complacency that comes with that. And then again, we need to be looking at that and why that's happening. Okay, so I wanted to just do a brief group discussion because I want to try and bring us all together to talk about what happens when we don't work together in an emergency department or as paramedics. Don't be shy, yell it out. Delays to patient care.
Can you hear me if I don't use the microphone if I occasionally put it down?
For streaming in it. Okay. My family often tell me I'm too loud, but here we go. So inappropriate outcomes it was, wasn't it? Yeah, and what did you say there in the back? What was your comment? Have we got that up there? Yep. Anybody else? What else happens when we don't work together? And you've all seen it. You know, I see it all the time. Teams against team. Yep. Very good. Anybody want to add anything more? Yep, it absolutely does. Risk to staff increases. Anything else before I move on? Yes, very good. And what happens when we have conflict? Nothing good, yep. So with that, that leads me right onto our TED Talk. So that's a good lead-in, unless somebody has something more to add. Because it is this brilliant TED Talk which I teach my team. And it's about when rudeness in teams turns deadly. So if we can just click that on, Quinton. Has anybody seen this TED Talk? No.
Passionate, it became heated, voices were raised, and eventually they decided to go with maximum drug therapy, and that they wouldn't do her breathing for her at this moment in time. The intensive care doctor left, he went back to his department, and the pediatric doctor started trying to get intravenous access in the little girl's arm. The nurses asked, "What do you want us to give next?" They spoke for a moment or two, and then they leaned forward and said, "How'd you make it up?" Because they were adult nurses, and there were no pediatric nurses in this department overnight, and you make it up differently for children and adults. He said, "Look, When they got back, he was still struggling to get his intravenous line in. They said to him, "What rate do you want us to go at?" He looked up and said, "For God's sake, leave me alone, can't you see I'm busy?" And they did what we would often do. They took a step back. They took a step back and they waited. And they got the line in, they wrote the script, and then connected the drug through the pump, through the tube, and into her arm. And over the next half hour, she received 15 to 20 hours worth of aminophil, a very toxic drug. So what happened next? Well, after a rocky few hours, she did just fine. But there was, of course, an incident form. There was, of course, an investigation. What did that find? It found that the nurses hadn't been competent. It found that the nurses needed retraining. In fact, the nurses shouldn't be allowed to give any drugs till they had retraining, and there might have been some communication issues. And I think we missed the point, and I think we missed the chance to be better. Many of us work in teams. Healthcare is no different. We deliver it in complicated, sometimes complex environments with varying outcomes. And for the last 10 years, as well as being an emergency medicine consultant, I've been a safety lead, investigating and trying to understand situations just like this one. And if 10 years ago you had come and asked me, said, "Chris, what do you think the answer is?" I'd have been totally clear with you. I'd have said it's process. If only everybody did what they're meant to do. But there's a problem with that. You can only investigate so many of these when you know that the people involved are knowledgeable, good, diligent professionals before you realise that you must be missing something. And I was missing this. Process is written on paper, but practice happens between individuals and in environments, and I simply wasn't respecting the complexity of the situation. So now people come and ask me, "What do you think the answer is?" I still think process has its place. But something else is more important, and that's people. And I think the evidence bears me out on this. So if we work in teams, what makes teams perform better? Well, in 2015, Riskin and Erics published the first of their landmark papers. In it, what they did was something that hadn't been done before. They took teams who were matched for expertise, they put them into a patient simulator and they measured the outcomes. Half of those teams were exposed to mild rudeness. And what did they find? They found, unsurprisingly, that we grade on a curve. We grade from the truly fantastic care that we all want for ourselves and for our loved ones, all the way around to the catastrophic care where patients die unnecessarily. And they found that one factor was responsible for 40 to 60% of that variance, and that's incivility or rudeness. In fact, it looks like for competent teams, the single most important factor determining the outcome of that team is how we treat each other. So incivility. If it's such a big deal, how come we don't know about it? I never got taught about medical school in my membership exams or my fellowship exams. It's because this is new science. Between 1996 and 2000, on all of the academic papers, there were only 23 about incivility. Really. Between 2011 and 2015, there were 1,700. And they pretty much all say the same thing, that this stuff counts. So I should ask, has anybody here seen rudeness at work? Maybe to you, maybe to somebody near you, Or maybe it's been by you. And it's certainly been by me. How did it feel? Now my guess is there's a bunch of people, when they're thinking about it, feel angry. But that's not where we start off. In the moment when it happens to us, we feel belittled, ashamed, humiliated. We feel powerless, like children. And then slowly, over minutes, sometimes hours, sometimes days, we start to make sense of it. And then we find ourselves saying, how dare you? How dare you treat me like that? And that's when we fight with the anger. So today, I'd like to talk about two of the groups that are affected by incivility. Because now, thanks to the wonderful work of people like Christine Porat, we're able to put some numbers onto this. And to do it, I'd like to talk about bandwidth. Because on a good day with a following wind, we're pretty smart people and we can deal with 5 to 7 things. But we have lives, we have cars, bills, houses, family, and it takes up space. So by the time we get to work, we're maybe dealing with 3 or 4 things. What happens when somebody is rude to another person? What happens to the recipient? And I'm talking here about mild to moderate rudeness. I'm not talking about screaming and shouting in your face. That's completely different. On average, when somebody is rude to us in a mild to moderate way, our bandwidth reduces by 61%. And then we cart it with us through the day. We cart this thought, what on earth happened? And then at the end of the day, we get in the car, we're on the bus, and we're sitting there and we feel a wee bit safe, and our bandwidth starts to open out again. And then we have that moment where we go, boom, that's what I should have said. That's what I would have said to him. And that's because in that moment, you're back. You're back to being the wonderful, smart, witty self that you are. And in the moment, you weren't. In the moment when it happened, we are quite literally less. When we do it to somebody else, we make them quite literally less. What about staff onlookers? Well, I'm reminded of an episode in the emergency department. My colleague tried to refer a patient onto the neurosurgical team. The neurosurgical registrar had said, no, and I know him, he's a good guy. I didn't know that he was a good guy having a bad day. I said, let me go and chat to him. Big. So I went along and I said, got this patient, really like to see her, neurosurgical problem. He said no. Second tactic. Listen, you know that patient? I'm pretty sure it's a neurosurgical problem. If I'd been smart enough at medical school, I'd have really liked to be a neurosurgeon. And you're here, and you think I'm joking, that really works. And you're here, and he said no. And I'm maybe beginning to get a wee bit angry. So I decided to drop the C-bomb, because that's the way I go. And I said to him, I need you to see this patient. I am telling you to see this patient because I am the consultant. And he looked at me. There's quite a lot of eye looking going on at this point. And he looked at me and he said, goodness, what do I care? I'm going to be a consultant someday myself. And I had nothing. We've said this. I can tell you in here today that the red mist can descend from the Pentland Hills, just as I said, Edinburgh, all the way into the emergency department Midlands in under about half a second. And as I stood there and my voice got louder, deeper, and more Scottish, and I drew myself up to a full 5'7" and a half. I saw two things happening. The first was that my wonderful, fantastic, amazing colleague, the nurse in charge, did precisely what her title says, and she belted around her desk, and she charged across to us because whatever this crap was, she wasn't going to let it happen in her department. And the second thing was this. I saw the heads starting to go down. First one, pop, then the pop, then pop, 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 pop. All these heads going down all around, all apart from one guy, 3.5 meters in that direction. And he's leaning against the desk and he's watching. And in my corrupted memory, he's opening a packet of crisps and getting a pallet. This is the most fun he's going to have all day. And I thought those guys were just going back to work. But they're not. The first thing they're doing is avoiding the eye of Sauron. Because we know that the way that somebody has just treated the last person is likely to be the way that you treat the next person. And something else is happening as well, because they actually have their bandwidth impacted too. And on average, they are 20% reduced in their performance. But there's more. Because if they get up and they walk around the corner and somebody asks them for help, they're then 50% less likely to help that person. This stuff is simply contagious. So is change possible? This is 1959. Western General Hospital in Edinburgh, the NHS is 11 years old. This is my mom. And next is my mom, Charlotte and Julie. They were forged as junior nurses in the NHS. They still meet and they still have coffee together.
We're just going to stop that.
Another word, twice a day.
Because there are little brilliant talks you do when you watch the end of it. And the reason why I put Chris on is because he can explain it much better than I. He comes across a lot more powerful than me standing up and trying to deliver that. So has anybody seen that in their workplace? You've never seen registrars upon registrars having a tussle?
Yet we see it all the time. You know, they're referred to mental health is saying not medically cleared, the ED registrar is saying medically cleared, mental health are going back. It is head to head. And the only person that really suffers in this is the patient, as well as us as staff members. So I think it's about taking note of what does happen when we don't get along, what does happen when rudeness appears, and looking at how we can change that if it does happen and how we can respond in, you know, in other manners. Anybody got any thoughts on that before I hand it over to Tahlia? Did anybody think that was a good TED Talk to show? Yeah. I use a lot in my training with my staff, and it really sinks in for them because they can really relate to it. So I think I have got the link there, and I think Quinton will be heading in our slides. So if anybody does want to use that and some of Chris's work, it's brilliant. But I'm going to pass you over to Tahlia. So she's going to try and do the description. Not try, she is going to do. She is also my daughter, so she is very much going to perform well, aren't you? Yeah. Okay, so I'll pass you over.
I know. Can everybody hear me? So I hate talking, so I apologise in advance. This is not my jam. But I'm just going to go through. Does everyone know what psychosis is? Yeah. So I'm just going to provide a little brief rundown. So it's a combination of symptoms that occur over a period of time, most commonly delusions, hallucinations, disorganized behavior and thoughts. That individual might experience a loss of touch with reality, which makes it very difficult for them to differentiate what's real and what's not. And that often impacts how we feel, how we think, how we behave. So looking at acute intoxication, and, you know, I don't know how everybody else felt after the winery yesterday, but I didn't feel very great this morning. So I feel like we've all somewhere along the way experienced intoxication. And we acknowledge that there's multiple substances, but in order to fit everything into this period of time that we've got here, we're just going to focus on the ones we primarily see coming through the department. So if you're looking at alcohol, so firstly, I feel like we all know what alcohol is and what alcohol does. So it depresses the central nervous system, impacting on one's mood, physical and mental abilities and noticeable changes, which can include impaired judgment, coordination, slurred speech, blackouts, depressed or anxious mood, especially in withdrawal, and an increase in risk-taking behaviour and an increase in misadventure. So the risk of alcohol withdrawal, if there is a risk of alcohol withdrawal if a person is dependent, and this is then a medical emergency. So in one serving of alcohol, this contains around 10 to 15 grams of ethanol. This accumulates in the body, in the blood, as it's absorbed, as absorption is more rapid than elimination. So you see the peak concentration between 30 to 90 minutes, with alcohol withdrawal manifesting as a continuum and often mimicking psychiatric symptoms. So it's important to know people can go into withdrawal with a high level of alcohol, therefore their BAL does not need to be zero for them to be seen.
And I think that's a really important thing to take note of. So if an alcoholic drinks a fair amount and often functions with a high level, they will go into withdrawal in high levels as well. So the myth that you need to be absolutely at zero to go into withdrawal, not true. Mm. I've seen withdrawal, you know, at 0.2, 0.25, it does happen, and we need to be aware of that. And later we'll talk about why we assess how much people use to try and help us determine that as well.
And just for some context, normally after around 6 hours from someone's last drink, if they are heavy drinkers, they'll experience tremors, weakness, like GI upset. Seizures can occur between 6 to 48 hours post last drink. Hallucinations around 12 to 24 hours. And then you've got your DTs between 48 hours and 72 hours. So that's a medical emergency. But I won't keep talking about that. So we've got our psychostimulants, so namely methamphetamines, amphetamines, MDMA, ecstasy, cocaine. So these stimulate the activity of the central nervous system, causing individuals to feel falsely or overly confident, a sense of euphoria, increased alertness and energy, can cause extreme agitation, irrational behaviour, impulsivity, paranoia, and may lead to the person behaving in an aggressive or violent manner. So looking at, you know, methamphetamines, for oral administration, the peak concentration is seen with 2 to 4 hours, while snorting, smoking, injecting it is within minutes, and the half-life range is between 6 to 15 hours. With cocaine, IV and smoking, we'll see immediate onset and peak between 3 to 5 minutes, duration lasting around 15 to 20. If someone is snorting it, you'll see the onset around 3 to 5 and peak again 20 to 30, duration lasting around 45 to 90 minutes. So if we look at our opioids, so that's an analgesia, sense of euphoria, sedation, again, central nervous system, depressant, peak is reached within 5 to 10, and if it's orally, can take up to 90 minutes. Each opioid will have a different half-life, so it's just important to know that buprenorphine and fentanyl are highly lipid-soluble, so they will have a very long, prolonged half-life. We got cannabis. So sense of euphoria associated with sensory intensification, sometimes illusions, and frank hallucinations are a very rare occurrence, however. Can last up to 4 to 6 hours. Elimination half-life is on around 7 days, with complete elimination taking up to 30 sometimes.
The other thing with cannabis, it does store in our fatty tissues. So often we do see if people start to lose weight or start to diet, it may increase that length as well.
We've got our hallucinogenics. Yep. And again, onset is around 30 to 60 minutes and duration can be 12 to 24 hours. And DMT, it's around 2 to 5 minutes with duration lasting around 20 to 60 minutes.
And that's often referred to as the businessman's lunch. I'm not sure if anybody has ever heard that term, but it's something that we definitely know it as on the Gold Coast.
Sorry, what's the DMT?
So
Talia struggles to pronounce this word, so let's...
I can't pronounce the big long word. But essentially, it is a hallucinogenic, but it also is something around the chemical that your body releases when you die as well. So it's like Does anybody else know that wants to chime in?
Die. I can't pronounce words. When I can't pronounce words, I throw to the Nun of Governance in AD. We'll find out. She'll Google it. So now we're going to talk about the treatment of intoxication. So there's lots of relevant acts that we use, and most of you would have the similar acts to what we do in Queensland. So Guardianship Act, definitely if somebody is intoxicated, they're not in their right frame of mind, it's deemed that they don't have capacity, they can't make decisions, they can be placed under the Guardianship Act. They have to be 18 and above. You cannot place a child under the Guardianship Act. We often do use in Queensland our EEAs, which is for our paramedics and police, so emergency examination orders. So that gives the police and ambulance the right to pick up, detain, transport for a period up to 6 hours to determine assessment of what's happening and a further 6 hours if deemed necessarily. So I also work with the ambulance as well as the co-responders going out doing mental health assessments. We will often sometimes use two acts. I might put them under a recommendation and my paramedic will use the EEA for transportation because I can't enforce any treatment under a recommendation, nor can I enforce transportation unless we do multiple forms to get police assistance. So it's much easier then to use the two acts. But the other relevant thing I wanted to mention about our acts, which we often see, is when people put an intoxicated person under the Mental Health Act. Is it legal? Nope. It's definitely not legal. And we see it happen all the time. You cannot put a person under the Mental Health Act if they're acutely intoxicated, because how can you determine that that person is having a mental illness compared to an organic issue or an acute intoxication? And what I often say to our consultants and registrars, who I do get along with really well, is there will be a day that somebody will sue you. You'll put somebody, the wrong person, under the wrong act. If I went to ED and you whacked me under the wrong act, I would come back tenfold, guns blazing. It has implications. I recently had to assess a young boy who's going into the army. It looks like he's had a prodromal period and he's developing first episode psychosis. This will probably absolutely impact him being accepted now into the army. So placing people under the Mental Health Act when it's not necessary has implications. So we need to be really careful and just think, as Stephanie mentioned, think about the bias. It has a label, because each time you then come into the emergency department, you're labelled. People look and go, oh, they were in not long ago and they were under a recommendation. Didn't mean they needed that. For children, we often use parental consent. If the parents aren't there, we will use the Mental Health Act, but again, we can't if they're intoxicated. We do have a Drug and Alcohol Act. We rarely use that in Queensland. And of course, we always get away with duty of care. If somebody's about to run out the road, step in front of a car, you have a duty of care to try and stop that. You don't just step back and go for your life. Oops, you're dead. Like, you would go a row. Lots of treatment is around psychoeducation. Lots of people need psychoeducation, whether it's harm minimisation around their use, whether it's education to the family members, or carers that are looking after the person. Lots of people really don't understand intoxication and what that means, and we'll come to that down the track. We need to look at risk assessments for the behaviour. What risk is this person at if they're acutely intoxicated, or if they've got a drug-induced psychosis or psychotic? We always, always would suggest thiamine, IV 300 straight up, if somebody is alcohol dependent. Our ED will often not do IV, much to my disgust, and we do IM, but best practice is IV. We have to protect the brain of the alcoholic. If we don't, what we're looking at down the track is Korsakoff's, and that's not something you can reverse. So even if somebody's choosing not to stop drinking, they should be on regular thiamine. You need to protect that brain. Naltrexone, again, for our overdoses of opioids, and we have an organisation in Queensland called Quinn. They routinely give out free scripts for naltrexone to their users and to the carers, because that's what will save the person's life when it's an accidental recreational overdose. We need to use a trauma-informed lens and recovery-focused framework. That's important for everybody that we see. Even if it's not mental health, even if you're working on a medical ward, you don't know what that person's been through. If that person's reacting in a way that they seem scared. Is this a person that's had trauma in their past? Are they a victim of DV? Have they experienced significant sexual assaults as a child? We need to look at why that person could be behaving in that way. And we need to look at our aggression management. In the past, I have presented for Dylan and Quentin, on how we treat, you know, acute aggression in mental health. There's ways we can do it, and there's ways we can train our staff up to do it to help minimise the risk of aggression and the impact that that has on the patient and staff and other patients around them. And we need to acknowledge the individual's substance use and the impact that it has on their behaviour. It's really important.
So, drug-induced psychosis. This is a form of psychosis that's brought on by substances. Most common symptoms are usually visual hallucinations, disorientation, and memory problems. Symptoms appear quickly, normally more intense, and they resolve following while the drug is metabolized through the body, or when they stop using substances. DIP differs. It can be quite challenging to differentiate the difference between DIP and other forms of psychotic disorders, as many people with primary psychotic disorders tend to have comorbid substance use disorders. So DIP differs from primary psychotic disorders, as I said before, as it appears when an individual is under the influence or withdrawing from substances, and again, comes on suddenly and more intense. So any drug which alters the brain's chemistry has the potential to trigger a psychotic reaction. However, alcohol, amphetamines, cocaine, hallucinogenics are among the most common that we see. DIP is also associated with an increase in risk towards self and towards others. The longer these symptoms are left untreated, the higher the risk that individual is at developing a primary psychotic disorder. DIP typically only lasts until the substances have left the body. However, heavy users can experience longer lasting symptoms. Individuals can present with symptoms of psychosis when they are also acutely intoxicated. Therefore, a diagnosis of DIP occurs when the patient's symptoms lessen as a psychoactive drug is excreted or metabolised. Therefore, it's quite important to be aware of the half-life of substances. So if we look at the treatment for DIP, first and foremost, it involves ceasing substance use and monitoring the individual in a safe and calm environment. Medications such as benzos and antipsychotics can assist with the symptoms of DIP, especially when dopamine-stimulating drugs like amphetamines trigger. A thorough risk assessment is essential. This includes the nature of the hallucinations or delusions, the risk of harm to themselves and to others, and also health risks. So looking at, you know, their increased heart rate, seizures, things like that. A period of time to allow the substances to be metabolized and for the medication to take effect is fundamental. Following this, the individual's presenting symptoms and risk should be reassessed.
The other thing just to mention of DIP, if anybody is talking about visual hallucinations, it's unlikely that they have a psychotic illness. So visual hallucinations are either a drug-induced psychosis or something organic driving it. Schizophrenics don't have visual hallucinations. They'll have auditory, they'll have tactile, they'll have olfactory, you know, but they do not have auditory. So if somebody, visual, if somebody comes in and says they're seeing things, alarm bells. There has to be substances or an organic cause.
And safety is of the utmost importance when caring for individuals experiencing DIP. The clinician's self-awareness and communication technique is very important when providing care. You know, using the individual's name to personalise the interaction. Calm, open-ended questions are always preferred. Being aware of one's non-verbal cues and body language is also really important. A non-judgmental and empathetic approach does help in assisting the development of rapport and engagement with that individual. It's important to remember that substance use is complex, therefore care from a trauma-informed lens is really important.
The other thing to mention about using of substances, often people that use substances either have a trauma background, or if they don't have a trauma background, when they start using quite regularly, they will often, 99.9%, develop some form of trauma throughout their use. Whether that's being sexually assaulted, whether that's being taken advantage of, whether that's getting into a DV relationship, whether that's being robbed. You know, there always comes some form of trauma associated with substance use.
I think it's really important to remember that that individual is likely experiencing a mixture of emotions, fear, confusion, and so on. Therefore, validating that person's experience and providing reassurance is fundamental. And psychoeducation is really important, not only to the patient, but to the family, to the caregivers, loved ones, and also to your colleagues as well, who may not have an understanding around DIP.
So how we try to determine the difference. And I think lots of this isn't rocket science for us in health, but sometimes we just need to be reminded. So we need to check the history. So often whether I'm working in the ED or I'm working with the paramedics, I'm checking the history. Does this person ever have a history of being psychotic? If no, it's very unlikely that they have a psychotic illness. Something is triggering it. There could be first episode, and again, you'd want to get that history around some prodromal symptoms there. We need to treat all psychotic symptoms. It really rattles me when people say, oh, we just want you to see them for how they are. We'll know how they are. Just treat them. 10 and 10 straight up is what I say. So as soon as they walk through the door, if they're psychotic, 10 of olanzapine, 10 of Valium. That's what we give at Gold Coast. And that's something I know that Bucko is very firm on getting her staff to, and the doctors, when they say, oh, we'll just try 2.5. The person's off their face. They're trying to rip your head off. 2.5 is not going to do it. We need to know a family history. Is there a family history of mental illness in the family? If there's not, and again, there's no history, then we'd really be looking at the substance use causing it. We know the half-life of substances. And my one big portion, I know it happens in every ED department, and I mentioned it before, this push and shove. ED says medically cleared, mental health says not in your nelly, and the patient suffers. So I say to my staff, know the half-life. We don't have medical clearance, we have fit for assessment. So if the patient is fit to be assessed, we will assess. If we know the half-life after 24 hours, if somebody's coming acutely off their face on ice, I'm sorry, you can assess. There's no longer pushing back saying they're still acutely intoxicated. Unable. Unless they're getting ice in the department and, you know, having a right old go and nobody's noticing it, the half-life's gone and there's residual symptoms, so continue to treat. And I always say to staff, if somebody came in with a broken arm, do you put them out in the waiting room, no pain relief, and let their arm fail? No, we immobilise the arm, we give pain relief. Same with psychosis. The longer we leave a person in psychosis, the more damage we're doing to the grey matter of that person's brain. And each time that they turn up with a drug-induced psychosis, as Tahlia mentioned before, the chance, which research firmly shows now, is that they will develop a permanent psychiatric illness if they don't treat it. So facts. There is millions of facts out here, and I've tried to really condense ones that I think are important just for this talk. But we know that intoxication and substance use are not unique to mental illness. You know, there's lots of people that don't have a mental illness that are out there using, whether it's recreational use. I mean, most people in this room don't need to put up your hands if you've ever used substances. But, you know, most people will ever use some form of substances. Alcohol's a substance, so, you know. So people do use substances. We know that. And we also know it's not common features of mental illness. But we also know that our mental health population have a higher prevalence of using substances. And they do that to manage symptoms. You know, often they have lots of what we call negative symptoms. So often they'll use stimulants to try and get some benefit to that or to feel better, you know. And when I worked for several years managing a medical unit in a drug and alcohol rehab. If somebody became unwell when they were clean, the high likelihood of relapse was, again, 99.9%. Because a quick shot will fix it all. And then one person only has to relapse and then the next person will relapse. The overshadowing, again, is my big bugbear. You know, it's problematic. These people don't get treated effectively. They fall through the cracks. And again, Stephanie spoke about bias for this population. Again, when I worked in a drug and alcohol unit, they would turn up. No GPs would see these people because they were deemed as being drug seekers, even though they weren't going there to seek drugs. We used to do a routine, really good physical exam. Their dental hygiene was appalling. So we know that dental hygiene problems can lead to cardiac problems. Most of them came in, they'd all agree, most of them had chlamydia, untreated. God knows how long it was untreated for. And there was often some that had physical illnesses that had never been picked up, that once we picked up and we started to treat. So it really sort of, you know, grates my grate when I see people just being quickly referred and nobody looking at their physical ailments because nobody in the community is going to do it for them. They'll just get turned away time and time again. And we know it has a higher prevalence of delirium and Korsakoff's. Korsakoff's is really irreversible. Once you've got those symptoms, we can try. The likelihood we will not reverse those symptoms. That's there. And that's why I strongly again push the need for thiamine. And if you're going to discharge, the education on why you need to regularly keep taking thiamine for your brain. We know organic can mimic mental health, and this is why we screen. An 80-year-old lady turns up to ED. First time she's got psychotic symptoms. Is she psychotic? Yep. Oh, well, you need to do an organic screen. Nobody all of a sudden develops schizophrenia at 80. Unknown, never heard of, can't happen. Just not possible. Something's causing it. Acute intoxication withdrawal can mimic mental health issues, and a large amount of the population use substances and needs that risk assessment. We need to know if it's at recreational level or at dependent level, because that then guides our treatment as well. Dependence indicates a person's ability to control their use. Dependence has the craving, a change in behaviour, impacts on their life. It's not just you have a hangover, one day a month and, have a sickie every now and then. And different substances can have different withdrawal symptoms and concerns, and we need to know that. We know, the two ones that are medical concerns. Does anybody want to call them out? The two things that we're concerned about in withdrawal? Yep, what causes seizures? What substance? Alcohol. What's the other substance that we're really concerned about if somebody's withdrawing? Benzos. If somebody's using benzos, you need to look at that withdrawal and you need to treat it effectively. That person will seize. And often people will underreport their use of benzos because they don't want to tell you how much they're using. And we've got an example coming up later of that. Australia, here's some more facts, and these are quite not really surprising, but a bit surprising. So 90% of men, 75% of women drink alcohol. Yep. Australia and New Zealand have the highest per capita intake of alcohol in the English-speaking world. Australia, 5.5% of all deaths and 4% of hospital stays, and 7% of Australians use sedatives and hypnotics daily. To me, that's a large amount when you look at that. And many people taking benzos for 2 weeks straight can have withdrawal symptoms. So don't, think that they won't. They will. And again, we know that THC is the most widely used. It's been around forever. So 2 in 3 Australians, 18 to 30 have tried marijuana. Opiates have a lifetime prevalence of 1% in Western countries. Look at USA, Southern Europe, 4.6. And health-related concerns associated with that. Amphetamines, coke, prescribed stimulants are commonly abused, and we see it. People take the no-dose or a stimulant to get them through an exam, or I need to stay awake, or I'm not functioning that well. How many people use propranolol when they go for interviews, or, our ED regs do it all the time. They're going for an interview, you pop a propranolol. I'm not saying that's abuse. I'm just saying there's often lots of stuff that we use in order to manage day-to-day life. So 10% of Australians use hallucinogens, and that's increasing. I think what we saw over COVID was an increase in hallucinogens and an increase in coke. Now, that really amazed me, and we'll get to that later. All of a sudden, there was an influx of money for people, and coke all of a sudden became something that was usable. Ooh, 30 minutes to go. Okay, we'll skim through. We know that. There's often that disapproval, intolerance, anger and disinterest in our population. I'll just talk about this case study quickly, and it's thanks to our AODS consultant, Dr. Hess, because he's got a huge name. So this was a case study that came in. A 35-year-old Indian taxi driver presented to ED. Nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, abdominal cramps, leg cramps, sweaty, runny nose, pupils are dilated. So on investigation, he's fit and healthy normally. No family members exhibiting any symptoms. There's no drug and alcohol and collateral supports, so he's not a substance user. He sought some herbal medication from the local Indian store to help with his hay fever with good effect. However, in the last 2 weeks, he's not been able to get any. It ran out of stock. When we asked of the herbal medication, he called it to be Kamini. Has anybody heard of Kamini? Keep it in mind. He reports feeling anxious and lowered mood. So what would you guys think the clinical picture is if you just saw that? Somebody comes into your ED, they're presenting like that. You pick them up as a paramedic. What are you thinking? Could be a toxin, yeah. Anybody else? Yeah. As Bucko said this morning, he's lying. Proved he wasn't lying. So how would we manage this? So he was in opiate withdrawal. So Kamini actually has opiates in it. And there's a lot of substances. When we looked at our toxicology pitch, there is even a cream that the person had a decrease in consciousness, and it turned out a cream they were using had clonidine, amitriptyline, and another substance. So the important thing is to ask what other things they're using. What creams are they using? What's in that cream? Google it. But there's the link for Kamini. So we'll become, you know, something to look for if somebody's presenting like that. What herbal, you know, things are they using? This is another interesting one, and I'll try and skip through it. This is a 48-year-old that presented to a police station wanting a lift home. He's married, male, high-functioning, good job, two children. He presented in a confused state, and they took him on an EEA. So an initial assessment, he was presenting as confused, poor historian. He'd had four standard drinks leading up to the presentation. He was on a yacht with four other people travelling interstate. He started to get really disorientated on the third day, started trying to touch all the equipment and was taking off his clothes. On the fourth day, they moored and he disappeared. So on review, he was under a private psychiatrist with bipolar type 2, but he'd been stable in that last week prior to that yacht trip. So it wasn't like he was leading up to have a manic episode, and it's bipolar 2. So the impression in ED was a drug-induced psychosis driven by an unknown substance. However, he's scoring 12 on the rapid delirium assessment. Yeah? So that should ring alarm bells. His MSE was confused, not orientated, persecutory delusions, tactile and visual hallucinations, and he was admitted for further assessment and treatment. So all the investigations were done. I'm just aware of the time, so I'm trying to skim through stuff. So it turned out that this guy was taking Finergan, high doses of Finergan, and was having an anticholinergic delirium. Hence, it wasn't, you know, substance use. It was accidental. I don't know why he was taking so much Finergan on the yacht, but he was. 4 days in hospital, discharged, no psychotic symptoms, into family's care. There was just a couple of others that we just want to reflect on between the team this morning, and just reflects why we should screen, and again looking at bias. So Verna, it's not her real name, but a lady that comes to us regularly, always, she's a PFO, always intoxicated, lovely lady when sober, the loveliest lady you could ever meet. When she's pissed, not so. She always falls over, she's a menace, she drives people mad. One day we had a new registrar who thought he'd be thorough, and we picked up, she had a subdural hemorrhage. So that would not have been picked up if somebody wasn't new and just was treating her like she normally was treated. We had another one recently that had a benzo delirium. So briefly talk about that one.
So it's a 45-year-old male came in, and everyone automatically assumed that he was intoxicated. We did EDS, it was all clear. He did say he was taking some alprazolam. However, he didn't tell us how much alprazolam he was actually taking, and it turned out as he progressively got worse, and the to and fro between mental health and MDU and ICU, because they were considering intubating him at the time because the behaviour was so unmanageable, that it came out he was taking up to 600 milligrams of diazepam a day, and he was in acute, he was experiencing withdrawal delirium, and it was a medical emergency.
He was making it.
Yes, he was making it. But again, it was a prolonged stay because, you know, it's that push between mental health and medical, and
And again, it just goes back to that reason why we should screen. And there was just one other that Bucko had in relation to the person that's recently been charged for assault for us.
So the thing that you really need to look out for as well is with our biases with these patients. We had a gentleman that come in, well known to be a user. He had a fall off a scooter, fell over, hurt his face, ended up with a bit of trauma to his face. They did a bit of a washout, gave him a script for oral antibiotics, sent him on his way. About a week later or something, he'd come back in, he'd lost his script, wanted another script for antibiotics. Pain in the, you know, everyone thought, yep, he's a pain, he just comes in all the time, he's just wanting whatever. But he didn't want whatever, he just needed a script. They gave him a script, discharge. Still, come back probably a week or so later, he now has a collection under his skin, in his cheek. doctors do the right thing, keep him for 24 hours, you know, give him, you know, some antibiotics, they, you know, clean out the wound again and whatever, send him on his way, give him a script again for antibiotics, probably comes back another 3 or 4 times. On one of the next times, we actually give him the antibiotics. So, because the reason that he's not taking it, he hasn't got the money for it. He's spending his money doing other things. The last time he comes in, which is about the 7th or 8th presentation, he gets taken into a bed. We see him. The doctor decides, yeah, there's nothing more we can do for you. You just need some oral antibiotics. Off you go. We'll change your antibiotics. He gets frustrated. This patient becomes really frustrated at the fact that he's not being listened to, he's not being seen. So he gets really frustrated, draws some scissors out, attempts to assault staff with scissors. He gets taken away, you know, sent out. He'll now be charged with assault because of his frustration, because we haven't managed this patient. We've had those unconscious bias about what this patient needs. He's representing, he's not... You know, it's all on him, it's his fault, where we haven't looked at the whole picture.
So again, it just goes back to that screening and just trying to think and ask those questions. You know, how will you get your antibiotics? You know, can anybody get you to the chemist to get those antibiotics, etc.? So just I want to put one patient's perspective because I think it's important. When I used to work the drug and alcohol rehabs, this is what they would say to me. They'd do anything to get on, things I'd never do when I wasn't using. At the time, nothing else mattered. I was wired, frustrated, and always thinking of ways to get on. But in actual fact, when you got them clean and sat them down, it takes less work to get clean than what it does to use. The amount of work they put into using, scoring, you know, getting some money, rubbing somebody, it takes a lot of bloody work. To get clean, yes, it's hard, but not as much work as what it is when they're in active addiction. So I'm going to skim through our guidelines because most of you will have guidelines, but I just... would like everybody just to refer back and look at their guidelines for assessment because I think it's important. I think it's reflective on everything we should do. We should always reflect back on our guidelines. As a team, we're always looking at policies, procedures, work instructions, etc. So the main thing is look for all physical ailments there. You know, treat intoxicated people like they've got a head injury unless it's deemed otherwise. Don't be judgmental, be accepting. Observe the suicidal behaviour, acknowledge the culture, and be aware of your own feelings and transference there. Skim past that one, that's just, yeah. Incorporate drug and alcohol use in order to assist with our care planning, identifying level, frequency, and associated risk of relevant scales. That's important to us. Are they at recreational level or dependency level? Don't be biased. Substance use population often shown disdain by GPs, as I mentioned before. And the risk of substance use on the body, as I mentioned, dental hygiene can lead to cardiac factors. So drug and alcohol assessment helps form care, a comprehensive treatment plan. You can look at all of those. I'm just aware of time again. Presents as a challenge for service providers. We know it's a challenge for all of us, but relapse in one disorder can trigger a relapse in the other among our population. The incidence of poor clinical outcomes, including a significant number of deaths in the mental health population, highlights the need for increased detection and management of this co-occurring population of, you know, other things that could be happening. A positive screen should trigger a more in-depth assessment. Skim past that. I'm just going to skim past this because I am aware of time. So I want to just reflect back to Amy. So this is Amy at the start of her career and Amy at the end. If she presented to your triage desk, would you be concerned about her physical state? Yep. She looks absolutely, you know, quite undernourished, doesn't she? She looks like she could have multiple physical problems. She was famous. Nobody really, you know, they gave her whatever she wanted. Same with many famous people. Put that into a homeless person who's a frequent presenter, we just discharge them. Put them in the waiting room. They often don't wait because they're put in a triage of 5 and they wait forever. So I just want to highlight that, you know, there's lots of famous people, and again, I mentioned that 27 Club that use, they have the money to get treatment. Doesn't mean it's good treatment or it's successful, but just reflect that everybody deserves the treatment. I'm going to skim past. This is just our data that we're looking at from the amount of intoxication that came through, and it was really hard because the main concern with our data is you only get one presenting problem when you come to ED. So we did note of the 14,561 presentations in 2022 for intoxication, it resulted in 1,592 differential diagnoses. And only 31% of those patients had to go to mental health. And again, that's on good screening. What does the person need? Do they need mental health or not? Can screen past that one. I put this one up for our paramedics because there is really good data for the paramedics to look at in each state how many incidents of intoxication paramedics go to. So I thought that was really interesting too. This is another one, and we did have handouts for this. Again, it's just looking at the psychological risk factors with drug-induced deaths. And you can see at the very top, the personal history of self-harm is ranked number one with all the substance use. It's just a really good chart to look at all the psychosocial stressors and put that against substance use and where they rank in the likelihood of dying. So we know the trends with our data. We know schoolies brings about an increase of presentations. So, however, Bucko will talk about our schoolies program. COVID, we had an increase of presentation, and we link that to job seeker. People had money, people were going out, getting off their faces, and then come to ED. We have had an increased boom, and when our borders opened, we did, I think in December alone, had 73,000 people cross over to Queensland to live. Which was amazing, but so it's driven, you know, our prices have gone up in houses, it's really impacted, we've got no more resources to count for all these people coming through, and Robina was undergoing refurbishment, which it feels like they've been undergoing refurbishment for years, so they won't take any aggressive or intoxicated people, so they get shipped up to Gold Coast to us. Also, if you're in the ambulance, like I often do, it's really problematic. You've got a really aggressive person. You're trying to de-escalate the whole way and you have to go a further 30, 40 minutes up the road. Triage, as I said before, you only get one presenting problem and we're often missing what's really happening for this person. So we are undertaking attempts to delve into their records and look at what's in the notes to try and pick out these people that we have missed in our data. And our department is busy. So Gold Coast, we've been really, I pride ourselves on really, as I said, being innovative, and we really look at our ED avoidance models and priority strategies. And our aim is to improve the consumer experience in ED. You know, we want to improve our patient flow, and we want to look at co-design models through collaborative relationships. So we have our schoolies model. We have our QAS and QPS mental health co-responder, which is mean I'm not going to spend any time on that because I think I'm talking for 2 hours in Bali. So anybody that comes to Bali will have to put up with me for 2 hours. We've got our watch house nurse, we've got our crisis stabilisation unit, and we've got our nurse navigators. So the co-responders, we have two on a late shift with QAS. Each one goes out with our LaRue officer, and our aim is to avoid bringing people into ED. And we also have one that goes out with the police, so I do both. You're in an undercover police car, you're looking at all the jobs on the Gold Coast, you're trying to pick out the ones that could be mental health, and we go out and assess on scene. So schoolies, do you want to give a quick verbal?
Okay, so who's been to schoolies on the Gold Coast? Anyone? Yeah. So, yeah, who came to my tent? So, schoolies has been going for quite a while now. So I'd got some numbers. So back in 2010, we had about 34,000 schoolies that presented to the Gold Coast. So we have what we call a schoolies response. We're not linked with schoolies.com. Schoolies.com is a private organisation that try and encourage kids to come to the Gold Coast. The schoolies response unit includes a whole range of people and services. So it includes the police, it includes council, it includes health, it includes the Red Frogs, what else? The Ambos. It's a huge response that we put together because these kids come and we have to make sure they're okay. So it's to service a community need, it's to provide a space for vulnerable school leavers because more than 50% of these guys are still under 18. And to get out of our emergency department. Like years ago, we used to clear our short stay, we used to put mattresses on the ground, and that's where we used to line them up. We used to give them, oh, it was awful. We used to give them all a bag, so many bags of IV fluid, put a nappy on them, and wait for them to recover and kick them out the next day. So we don't do that anymore. So we have an emergency, what we call an emergency treatment centre, down at the schoolies precinct. So it's a huge tent. We work really closely with QAS because they actually started the health response many years ago. It was just two QAS officers under the steps of a surf lifesaving club, and they used to suture because it used to be Fight Club many years ago because it was just alcohol. They were left to their own devices, whereas now we have lots of stuff together. Do you want to click through? So this is what it normally looks like in the mosh pit. So what we provide is a health agency. We provide a safe space. We provide medical treatment. We have a social worker, and we also have a team of mental health clinicians. You've got to remember, this is the first time these kids are away from home, and we want to have a positive impact on them. So this is our resus base. So we can actually intubate down at schoolies zone. So we have ventilator and all the stuff that we need. Next one. So this is out the back. So this is what we call our sort of where patients, if they present, they can't actually hold their own head up. So we actually have them out the back. QAS normally manage this with one of our senior consultants and a couple of nurses. And this is sort of like our recovery zone. And when we finish with it at about 2:30 in the morning, it then becomes a sleep out service for all the kids that get stranded. So this one here, this first picture, is that's where our social worker sits, and the social worker is there specifically for sexual assaults. The next part is where our mental health team are. So there's four mental health clinicians that come down with us every night of schoolies. And then the next one is a wellbeing space. So up the top is just a group of us. That's another sleep out zone. Just a few pictures of what our tent looks like. Next one. So in 2013 was a big year. So we had 699 presentations over the 7 nights, but it's gone down to about, I think we had about 403 presentations last year. So that front zone, we commonly call that our spew garden. So the kids get brought in and we sit them there, and it's seriously a friend holding their hair, or, you know, holding their head up and letting them spew. And our treatment, that's all the team together. Our general treatment now for the kids, because they always, it's a sort of mix of alcohol-induced vomiting, but there's lots of drugs as well, and there's lots of Nangs use. Everyone know what Nangs are? Yeah, so there's a huge amount of that.
Talking about the Nangs, there was, I think, a case in 2018 or 19, okay, was the first responder to a young boy, recreational use of a Nang, and leapt off the 26th floor to his death. Now, that happened, it was accidental, it happened in front of his group of friends he was staying with in that room. So we got brought in straight away, we went down, we sat with the kids, we moved them out of that room, we helped them pack up, we contacted the family, and I sat in a room with those traumatised kids until their parents could arrive from New South Wales, just providing mental health first aid.
So also on the Gold Coast for a couple of years now, probably for a good 10, 15 years, we've actually had a nurse provide care to persons in custody in the watch house. Does anyone else have that sort of service in their area? Oh, whereabouts are you from? Perth. So it's sort of like a new thing, and we're trying to expand it. So this actually prevents patients, again, coming up to the ED, but it's also about providing care for persons in custody, making sure that they're, you know, if they're going to go into withdrawals, we have medication there for them, because police can't give out medications. They can give out like a Panadol and things like that, but we need to make sure that they're medically safe to be in custody. And we also try and make it prevent them coming to ED, so for simple wound dressings and stuff like that. Because every time a police officer brings a person in custody to our facility, they sort of, there has to be two of them, and they stay there for hours. So it's about providing the police with a way that they can still remain on road. Go to the next one.
The other thing with that too, our co-responders will go out. If the nurse finds that it's something that they can't manage, it needs mental health care, we'll go out, assess and leave the person in custody with our recommendations.
So, we've done that.
Yeah, this is just a brief one. Maybe 4 years back on Gold Coast, I'm pressing things without knowing, Tahlia, we developed our crisis stabilisation unit. So it was a unit set up purely to take the pressure again off ED. So it was a centre where we could take mental health patients for assessment. It's staffed by mental health clinicians and people with lived experience. So there's no beds, there's chairs, and people can stay up to 24 hours. They really started off with quite a tight inclusion criteria, and we've expanded that. So now they will take intoxicated people, they will take people in withdrawal, and they will manage medical issues. The people just have to be not going to fall over, not a huge aggression risk, and not going to assault staff. But it really is starting to take pressure off our EDs as well. In the past, we've also had our mental health rapid response, which is a model of care I love because I developed it. So we're actually looking at re-implementing this, and that was where a mental health clinician, CNC, with the consultant of ED, would meet police or ambulance within 10 minutes of arrival if the person was brought in on an EEA, and we would plan their care. And we would administer medication, we would give education, we would take them off the orders if they didn't need to be on it, and we actually decreased code blacks, which is our aggression in Queensland, by 22% alone just at doing that. And we also had hub positions to assist in the QAS hub. And we're now also a new model of care. We're pitching for a toxicology unit within our ED. So we acknowledge we need to treat these people better. And so we've got two toxicology consultants, I think now, Bilsey and Sanj. Yeah. So we're starting to get it moving. And our inclusion criteria is going to be when medication or drug ingestion related assessment is needed, bites and stings, all inhalation exposure, dermal exposure, any patient that needs a consult with the Poisons Information Centre, they will get a thorough risk assessment on arrival to ED and stream to that area. So that risk assessment will be done. There's no way anybody can get out of that now once we get this up and running. And our aims is just to provide that ongoing collegial response, right patient, right pathway, right area that they need to be, always looking at our guidelines. Are they up to date? Do they need tweaking? Is it working? No longer any early referrals to mental health unless indicated. As I said, we don't have medical clearance. We have fit for medical assessment and psych assessment. QAS can administer droperidol. We're looking at a pilot where QAS can also administer Zyprexa, so an antipsychotic on scene, and we're hoping that will sit with the co-responders. We're also looking at the co-responders being able to administer medication with QAS, so we can start to administer more antipsychotics and more benzos on scene and again leave these people with follow-up rather than bring them in. So that's quite exciting. We've talked about our toxicology unit and our continual education. We're looking at, there's one thing that we are going to look at, and I don't know if anybody's heard of the BROSET violence checklist for ED. Yeah. So I recently presented the access and quality for mental health and emergency departments in Melbourne, and I sat next to Annalise Sens. Is anybody from Footscray? So she's the director of ED at Footscray Hospital. They had the most increase of adverse events and aggression, and they were told do something about it. So she actually looked at this model. They implement it as soon as the person hits ED and every time the OBS are done. So every half an hour, it's a really quick model, and it picks up if the person's agitation is increasing, so you can implement care earlier rather than waiting for shit to hit the fan. And we all know this. So the outcomes of intoxication on staff is that vicarious trauma, assault on staff, staff burnout, counter-transference. It impedes our workplace culture, impacts on our collegial practice, and we're not adhering to the KPIs. And the impact on patient and family, the poor health outcome for our patients, it's a higher mortality rate. The length of stay is often increased. Agitation, aggression, and the use of that suboptimal treatment. The trauma on family, increased level of violence, overshadowing and no linkages. And also what's commonly found is that we will often discharge and patients get really angry. Be it on your head when this person kills themselves. Well, that's not a nice thing to say. Not my fault. But so that's really hard. So trying to, understand the impact for patients and trying to make sure that we're linking them appropriately as well. Questions or comments? And let me see if I can say this right. Kia ora. Where's the, there's one New Zealand doctor. Therese, where are you? Did I say it right? Yes, thank you. So any questions or comments? So we've really tried to condense it. Oh, yep, up the back. Yeah, we do. Yep. It should be. We changed it from mental health point of view a long time ago. I can have a look. It should be on there. It's it was deemed because we constantly had that battle of medical clearance. So we need to look at, somebody can still be undertaking some form of treatment in ND, but they can actively participate in assessment.
Yeah, yeah. We just have significant issues with bed blockage
waiting for
clearance.
Like, yep.
Yeah, mental health won't get involved, so that's
the case. Yep.
Yeah, we need that too.
Yep.
Please,
please,
for Luke.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We used to have a procedure document that was for the rapid assessment, that was the best thing, where we had the clinician with the consultant that actually met them. That was probably the best thing that we had. But whereabouts do you work?
In Queensland.
Yeah, so you should be able to get on QEPS on, if you can go to Gold Coast,
yep.
Or at the back of this.
Yes, but
you
can talk
yeah.
Something useful that we can bring to the table.
Absolutely. Yeah, but it's in our EEA policy, I'm pretty sure, and it's got fit for assessment in there. And we've got a document where the doctors sign it off.
Great, thanks.
We also have a nurse can sign that off as well. So at triage, if there's no, there's a tick box. If they tick all no's, it can be a nurse designated sign up. Proactive work instruction. Anyway, I'll find it for you.
Yeah, we've got a similar thing with nurses, but.
Yeah, and I think lots of that comes down to we work really hard on relationships between the teams and try to get everybody to work together. So I often say, you know, if that was you, do you want to be waiting 5 hours because you've got a low triage score to be seen, and then waiting further 5 hours for mental health? It's disgraceful, I think. If you're fit to become fit to depression and anxiety, why the hell are we taking blood, doing an ECG when there's no need? That comes to clinical judgment, I think. The model. So yeah, they took it away from us, but they're now looking at re-implementing. Hooray. It was very successful.
We have a mental health liaison nurse. So in our mental health pod that's in our ED, we have a senior nurse. It's supposed to be a senior nurse, but it depends on staffing. And it's a mental health liaison nurse, and they're supposed to meet the patient, try and get their medications done. But a lot of the time, because they're not confident in that mental health role, like if you have a mental health clinician in that role, it works a lot better. But when you have an ED nurse in that role, they're limited exposure to that mental health. And because we have so many roles that have to be filled by senior nurses, it becomes difficult.
You mean fit for assessment, or the tick box?
Yeah.
No.
Yeah.
No, you get scanned in later on, I think, from ED.
Yeah. So we have really close relationships at GCUH with QAS. We have regular meetings with them. We have a meeting every morning with QAS. We look at bed stock, but we have meetings with QAS, the inpatient mental health guys that tell us how many beds they've got and stuff like that. And we have mental health huddles every day between the mental health liaison nurse, the mental health clinicians, and a consultant. So we sort of try and make sure that we all work together for the benefit of the patient.
And saying that, it's changing culture of the mental health team too, so I'm regularly telling our staff it's fit for assessment. You know, and same with intoxication, do not push back on the phone. Go down, visibly speak to the patient. How can you tell somebody's intoxicated by speaking to the registrar? Come. So if they're saying they're medically cleared, you can go and have a review yourself, and then you can have an explanation why you can't assess. Yeah. Any more questions?
Yeah.
I worry about that too much, and we all can get a bit of clarity and when you can put someone in the diagnosis and procedure. So EA should only be used by QAS and QPS bringing in. So ideally that's used if the person's deemed to not have capacity or something's impacting on them.
lots in the past used to say it was just for suicide. It's absolutely not just for suicide. If the person is suspected delirium, if you know, they're just intoxicated or, yeah, that they can use the EEA. The Guardianship Act comes when they hit the hospital, and guardianship is 18 and above. So people often get confused. You cannot put a child under the Guardianship Act, and it has to be the person doesn't have capacity. Once they have capacity, you cannot use the Guardianship Act. So if you use it for intoxication, they sober up, guardianship's no longer effective because they're sober and can make decisions. Yeah. But again, we did lots of education to our doctors, nurses around all of that and all the relevant acts. And I used to have a flow chart that I would direct people to look at. No other questions? Okay. Thanks, guys, and thanks, Britt and Dylan, for having us back. Thank you for listening to the Impacted 90 Minutes. You're probably dying to have a drink. But yeah, so hopefully that was made some sense and you got something out of it. As I said, we could speak for days on this subject, but yeah. I do have gifts to give out, so maybe I have to think of something at the closing party. Who can do the most shots? No, that's very irresponsible.
Well, I guess I'll be closing party. Good segue, thank you. Just for those who may have misplaced their lanyard since Monday night, tonight might be the one to start looking for it, or come and see myself or Dylan, we'll get you a new lanyard card. We just need those ones to get you guys nice and quickly through the door at World Bar. So pretty much you have your lanyard, we don't need to find your name on a list and tick it off. It will be an 8:30 start at World Bar, at 8 p.m. start, 8 p.m. start at World Bar. They do have some, they call it like the late night food menu, so there's I think some fried food that you can get, but we recommend probably trying to get something to eat before you rock up. And then yeah, we'll have a whole host of drinks for you all for the first couple of hours, and we might speak to Bucko to get the spew garden happening or something like that to look after that for us. Apart from that, have a great night, same deal tomorrow. Kim's got some goodies. Please, if you've got any other questions for Kim or the guys, have a chat to them. Otherwise, have a good one. We'll see you here tomorrow. Cheers.
I do the same thing. I told you that I never would. Told you I'd change, even when I knew I never could. Know that I can't find nobody else as good as you. I need you to stay. Need you to stay. I get drunk, wake up, I'm wasted still. I realize the time that I wasted. I feel like you can't feel the way I feel. I'll be fucked up if you can't be right here. Even when I knew I never could, know that I can't find nobody else as good.